In case you missed it, here's Dave and Cheryl's favorite moments of the week.
Online scammers, they're out trying to get our money all the time. And this is a story of how a school was almost scammed out of $100,000.
So a woman, Dr. Jan McGee is her name, is the principal of a charter school down in Florida. And she was actually forced to resign after she fell for an online scam. She thought she was talking to someone who was claiming to be Elon Musk. It wasn't a knee-jerk decision either. She actually sent him $100,000.
Or at least tried to do that too, right? So they had chatted about him investing in her school. She mentioned the conversation to her staff, and they were skeptical, as you can imagine, some even warning her, hey, this sounds like it's a fraud.
But she believed in fake Elon. So when he asked her to send $100,000 to his right-hand man, she fired off a check from the school's account. No questions asked.
So the details are hazy, but she put matching funds in the memo line. She was apparently under the assumption that writing this check would lead to Elon giving the school a $6 million donation.
It never works that way, people.
No, it does not.
Fortunately, the school's business manager caught wind of the payment in time, and they were able to stop the check before it cleared.
And here she is announcing her resignation and the board chair talking a little bit about what happened.
I am a very smart lady, well-educated. I fell for a scam.
Somehow she believed it. Matching funds with this guy, and he was supposed to give like $6 million to the school.
I put myself into this position and into this mess, and I made a bad decision.
I mean, how embarrassing in some ways, too. And that's why people don't come forward. And this, we're not saying this or telling you this story to embarrass her.
No.
But as a reminder, it can happen to anyone. As she mentioned, she's a highly educated person. But in her head, she was convinced that this was the guy that owns Twitter, Elon Musk, and all those other things he owns.
And it's just another reminder, too. If you're not sure, you know, talk to someone you know or trust. And if they tell you they think it's a scam, maybe you should believe them and listen to them.
Because things can happen so quickly. And I've heard of this scam before, right? Oh, we'll give you this money, but you gotta, or you've won this money, but you have to pay for the processing fees. Or the other one is, you know, remember that one where you did call the phone, it's the captain calling, right? Do you remember that one?
And
you've won a cruise, right? So I followed it through one time a few years ago, and he goes, oh, we just need your credit card to confirm it. And he was like, it was some bank that I don't even bank with. It was their credit card. Well, this credit card specifically. I'm like, okay, well, you ready? You got a pen? I just started reading off numbers. He goes, I think you've given me too many numbers. I said, you know what's weird? I don't even own that credit card. And he hung up. Point being, though, scammers are getting so sophisticated, you can easily get taken in. Be careful.
Yum. Science. Not rocket science.
Check it out. I blinded us with science.
Don't you run it in with science.
Well, the NHL, NBA heading off to the playoffs. Baseball just started too. And that might be a good thing because new research suggests that if you're feeling alone or dissatisfied, attending live sports events may help you improve your level of well-being and reduce that feeling of loneliness.
Oh, that's fantastic news.
So they analyzed data from over 7,000 adults and found that those who had seen any type of live sporting event within the past year were more likely to say they were satisfied and had a greater sense of, quote, life being worthwhile. So researchers observed the same impact with loneliness. They say the benefits received from attending a sport in person is comparable to that of being employed. And physical participation in sport also improves well-being and reduces loneliness. Well, for some of us, that's why we play sports. Mm-hmm. It's just for the camaraderie. A little bit of exercise, but...
And going to cheer on a sport, I guess, gives you that same feeling of being a part of something bigger than yourself.
Although with the cost of going to a live sporting event for major league sports these days, you need two full-time jobs to be able to afford those tickets.
Exactly. Hey, if we want to live on Mars someday, we're going to have to build stuff up there. So a team in England recently came up with a new material that'll be perfect on Mars. It's called Starcrete. It's like concrete, but stronger. And it only has three ingredients. Potatoes, Mars dust, and a pinch of salt.
Where are they getting Mars dust from?
Have they brought stuff back on that rover?
I'm not sure.
I don't think they
had that kind of thing.
Or are they just using regular dust and they're theorizing that Mars dust would work in the same way?
Something similar with a sand that would have to be in concrete, right?
I'd say it's got potatoes and a pinch of salt. Could be delicious.
Hey, Australia is still finding spiders. Imagine this. They discovered a new type of, quote, trapdoor spider. No. that can be up to 2 inches wide. No. And it lives for 20 years. Well, until you step on it. They're called that because they build trap doors out of leaves to catch their prey, and they spring up at you. They're not dangerous to humans, though. They say just very, very ugly.
Great.
Not real attractive. Mm-hmm. Like every other spider in Australia.
None of them are good looking, let's be honest. And finally, there's a group of scientists who have dedicated their lives to growing different types of sustainable meat. The latest meat they have come up with is a woolly mammoth meatball.
These are cells that are often obtained from an animal and then grown. We can take an almond-sized, about the size of the tip of your little finger, we can take that small biopsy from an animal and then produce enough food to feed cities and countries.
Dodo nuggets were actually, when we set out on this journey, was actually the first idea that we had. We pivoted to mammoth because there's just more information known about it.
And they were able to get some genetic material from, I think, one of these woolly mammoths that they have found frozen in the ice up north. But how does it taste? No one knows. No one has tried the woolly mammoth meatball. They say because it's a protein we haven't eaten for thousands of years, they're worried about how the human immune system would react to it. So they're not letting anybody taste it.
Good, because that's how the zombie apocalypse is going to start, right?
Well, so instead it is on display in a science museum in Amsterdam. Now, they do say if they do this again, they're going to make a version people could actually try. And specifically, they said T-Rex meat is probably doable.
Again, I don't know that they'd want humans eating T-Rex meat per se, but the practical applications for this are fantastic, right? You can cut down on, you know, the production involved, and for people that don't have access, could be really good for them.
I'm just saying for these people that don't want to eat anything that's genetically modified, yet you're okay eating a woolly mammoth meatball?
How about this? On the Flintstones, they used to eat brontosaurus burgers. Could we have one of those? Well, there was an entire drama played out between a man, his wife, and another woman online in a series of videos.
So this wife found another woman's checkbook in her husband's car. Now, he swore he had no idea who it was or how it got there, but she was still suspicious. So the guy was able to track the woman down, who the missing checkbook belonged to. She never answered anything, so then he just put out a random plea on social media for her to check her voicemail.
I'm in Northern Colorado. I need you to check your voicemail right away, because I have your checkbook. My wife thinks we're having an affair. She goes into the center console, and guess what she finds? A checkbook. Not mine, and not hers. It's yours, Jessica. I have absolutely no idea how I ended up with your checkbook in a console of my car. So we Google you. You work in the same town I teach in, which is not the same town I live in. Do you see how bad this is looking for me? I need you to just check your voicemail so we can figure out where we somehow crossed paths, or not even we, you and my car, so that I can clear all of this up.
So she finally saw that plea and put out her own video.
It's Jessica. I live in Northern Colorado. I never answer my phone.
Hey, we found Jessica. After texting back and forth all morning, the best we can come up with is that our kids go to school together. She maybe parks where I park because I teach next door. It's the best we got. So this afternoon, I'm going to meet up with Jessica, take the whole family over. She has goats, and so we're going to play with them. She's getting her checkbook back. And while half of the 15,000 comments and growing on this post are convinced that I am like the world's greatest infidelity mastermind, sorry to disappoint you guys.
So she uses checks all the time. So some people are like, well, who uses a check in 2023? Because she's got this hobby farm. She says she pays for a lot of feed and stuff like that with checks.
Oh, okay. Yeah, but yeah, instead of credit card.
So she goes through a lot of checkbooks. So is it possible that he found it? Did she drop it beside his vehicle and he just threw it in the console and forgot about it?
Did someone walking by see it on the ground and assume it was belonged to somebody whose car was there and opened the door and threw it back in because the car was unlocked?
Or is he the greatest infidelity mastermind, as he said? We've got a couple of stories of law and disorder. And for this first one, yeah, I'd say this was a fireable offense.
A longtime employee at a water treatment plant down in Louisiana was fired and arrested after he was caught peeing in the town's water supply.
Peeing in the water.
His name is Michael. He's 57, and it's not clear how many times he's done this. But they caught him on video doing it at least twice. So here's what he would do. He would move the security camera so it couldn't see him. He'd pee over the railing into a water tank below and then shift the camera back when he was done. So I don't know if he was just being lazy and didn't want to walk to the bathroom, or he had some other sort of nefarious reasons. But when he did it recently, apparently he didn't shift the camera enough so you could see what he was doing. He's now been charged with 2 counts of contaminating water supplies and criminal damage to critical infrastructure.
Officials put out a statement assuring people that the water was safe to drink. They say they took water samples and don't feel that the public was ever in danger. However, it's just the thought of it.
All I can think, though, is, dude, are you not smart? Like, this is your water supply, too. If you live in this town, now you're taking a shower in your pee water.
Unless he lives somewhere else and drives. Hey, so with a lot of the issues that airlines have had over the past year, we all know about bags going missing and lost, and then they're piling up. Well, this guy lost his bag.
Yeah, a man lost his bag at the airport in Atlanta, the baggage claim. And he didn't lose it, though. Some guy just walked up and took it, walked off with it. And the only reason he was able to find it was the bag had an AirTag tracking device in it.
I'm going to baggage claim and all that, trying to look for my luggage. Standing there for like 30-some minutes or so, not seeing it. Eventually, I pull my phone out because I have an AirTag in my luggage. After I seen that, it was not in the airport. It was actually in Grady. This silver one right here, I have a tracking device in here, and I tracked it here to you. And you have my shirt on. That's insane.
That was so many.
My shirt and my jeans.
Yeah, so he said security at the airport wasn't much help, but he was able to track it himself and confronted the thief with a police officer. And as you heard, the guy was wearing one of his own shirts and pants.
Luckily, he did manage to get everything back, and the thief was charged with theft, unlawful removal of baggage, and also trespassing, because it sounds like he just walked into the airport, took the bag, and then walked off.
Now, for what it's worth, the airport claims there are officers there to prevent people from taking bags that aren't theirs. But if you fly very often, you know there's oftentimes they're just sitting there and no one's doing anything.
I've never understood why you don't pick up your luggage still in the secured area of the airport and then go out into the to the regular area.
Yeah, because if you're
never been
delayed,
able to wrap my mind around that.
Someone could easily take it off the carousel and just walk away. This is an interesting A for effort, I guess, for Murphy, the bald eagle who thinks a rock is an egg.
So Murphy lives in a bald eagle sanctuary in Missouri, and he hurt his wing a long time ago, can't fly. So that's why he hangs out at the sanctuary, lives with 4 other bald eagles. But for whatever reason, he decided that a rock that he found in their enclosure was actually an egg. So he built a small nest on the ground around it, and he's been sitting on it waiting for it to hatch.
Oh, that almost makes me sad.
He's also protecting it so the other eagles don't get too close to it.
The rock isn't even round. It's sort of flat and jagged on one side of it, but he thinks it's an egg anyway. And helping with eggs is normal for male bald eagles. They help to raise the chicks, too. So that part's not weird, just the fact that it's a rock, and he's been waiting for over a week for the rock to hatch.
Now, people online have named the egg. They're calling it Dwayne the Rock after Dwayne the Rock Johnson. Now, if you do feel bad for Murphy, you shouldn't. The sanctuary workers say he's perfectly content with the rock, and he's not sad at all. They say this sometimes happens, and when it doesn't hatch, they said the eagles don't show any signs of depression or anything. And they think this is all just a hormonal response because it's spring. This is around the time when female bald eagles do lay the eggs. So it's like sort of built into the men as well that, okay, it's time to help out, time to, you know, sit on the egg and help it hatch.
He's very protective of the rock, and he just seems very content with his rock. He might sit there for a little bit longer just to, you know, because it hasn't hatched. I don't think anybody has to tell him. I think he'll figure it out.
Well, they say it usually takes about 35 days, so it's been a week or so far. So
he's got about a month or so to go.
A few more weeks to go before he leaves the rock behind.
How did you know?
I know. It was amazing.
I just happen to know, that's all.
No. Yes. I don't know.
You know, these aren't jokes. These are thoughts. These are things that make you go,
Like to make your partner a little happier? Hold their hand. 75% of women wish their partner held their hand more.
Guys, if you're listening right now, when you next time you see your girlfriend or your wife, hold her hand.
So the older couple around the corner from us out for a walk, and they were just holding hands. Oh, now they may have been holding each other up, but they were holding hands.
That might be the case. Hey, 70% of adults say they can't sleep if there's a spider in the room. Are you in that group, Dave? I know you're not a big fan of spiders.
It depends on the spider. I saw somebody post about going on vacation, and it was a spot where they could get tarantulas.
They had a tarantula on their face in their hotel room. Oh, I wouldn't be sleeping. I'd be like, well, that's it. I have to burn the hotel down now. 50% of men say they couldn't tell you their partner's shoe size.
Well, when are you ever looking in your partner's shoe, though? And
unless you've ordered or bought shoes for them, you might have an idea, but you might not know the exact size.
Yeah, I don't know if I would want you buying, ordering me shoes, Dave. You'd pick out something ugly, probably. Hey, 31% of people say they carry an extra pair of pants in the car. Apparently, 31% of people have had an accident.
Maybe.
In the past.
23% of women say they would actually pay their partner to give them a foot massage. Some people hate feet. Some people don't want their feet touched at all.
Hey, 20% of people say they would fail a written driving test if they were asked to do it right now.
A written driving test?
A written driving
test. How about a road test? Because I think there's a few that could use that.
Yeah.
16% of adults say they only eat ice cream when it's hot outside.
Well, now you're just missing out on eating ice cream all year round.
I understand that, though, right? It's a hot day. You connect it together.
How do you feel about this as someone with a pool, Dave? 6% of people say they're okay with peeing in the pool.
That's why we always told the kids when they were little, oh, there's a chemical in there. If you pee in the pool, everyone's going to know.
It'll change color.
And finally, 3% say they haven't used a pen or a pencil in the last year.
I guess they write everything on their phone or iPad.
Everything's notes. Online. The owners of a Dairy Queen in Phoenix, they recently had something rather unique stolen. Three people stole a 15-foot red spoon that was bolted to the ground outside of the restaurant.
This happened about a week or so ago, in the middle of the night after the place was closed. And the spoon was anchored to the ground, and it was a popular spot for photos. You know, people would take selfies with it. Except three people showed up with a flatbed trailer one night. So clearly it wasn't a spur-of-the-moment thing, and they'd obviously planned it all out.
He's seen cutting the spoon from its hold-it area, grabbing the spoon and walking off and loading it into the trailer of his truck. They did come prepared with the trailer. It's a very large 12 to 15-foot red spoon that we're looking at here.
They described it as two men and a, quote, very fashionable woman. Police were hoping someone would turn them in. Now, the owners at the time said, look, if someone just drops it off, we won't ask any questions. It costs $3,500, twice that with delivery and installation. And the owners also offered a reward. If someone was to find the spoon and report it, they would get a free Blizzard in every flavor this summer.
Well, someone has found the spoon. Thanks to Pokemon Go, actually. A guy by the name of Michael was out playing Pokemon Go when he spotted the spoon outside of his school. So he called police and they came and picked it up. No word on if he gets to collect the reward, though.
He should, though. He should be getting Blizzards throughout the summer.
A free Blizzard in every flavor this summer sounds like a delicious challenge.
You've been listening to Dave and Cheryl's favorite moments of the week.